Welcome back to the MathCast podcast, brought to you by the MathCast audio blog. Today, I am joined by poet, author, and content creator extraordinaire and all-around nice guy. Welcome back to the show, Terrence P. Elmore. What's up, man?
What's going on, man? Appreciate it. Glad to be back.
Oh, man. Glad to have you back. So, people don't know that we had this really, I wouldn't say heated, but because, you know, we agree, it was an engaging conversation about religion, church, right, and all that. And, oh, boy, did it get us in the mood for what we're talking about today. So let me tell you how all this started off. We'll give a little background. There was bonus content that was created, kind of like a like impromptu type of thing. So last weekend, wife and I were watching TV upstairs, right? And my mom called. I'm like, why is my mom calling me? You know, it's okay, my mom called, but she called at a time during the day where she doesn't usually call. So I'm like,
okay. Right, I feel you. I get that sometimes when my mom calls. I'm like, is everything all right?
Yeah. So I answer the phone, and she's like, well, we got Jeffrey over here, and, you know, he's talking about Adam and Eve, and I think we need to record this. I'm like, I'm game. So April and I went immediately downstairs, sat down. I sent the link out, and we started recording. You know, it wasn't the greatest audio quality, but I couldn't miss that moment, right? So you listened to it, and you sent me several texts laughing.
Yeah.
And April suggested that we have a podcast to talk about some things as a follow-up to it, because you are a religious person, I'm a spiritual person, and we have thoughts about how all this came to be and about Easter in itself. So I guess we go over that and, you know, see how we feel. But before we get to that point, let's catch up a little bit. How have you been?
Oh, man, I've been doing pretty good, man. Just getting into April, which is National Poetry Month. So trying to get some stuff together for this whole month, trying to still promote my last book. And it's The Essence of Love. You can get you an autographed copy at thebrownsugarcafe.blog. And just trying to, because when I launched it last year, COVID jumped off. So my promoting it has been kind of touch and go.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to kick that back off and see where we go from there, since it's National Poetry Month.
Good. Very good. If anybody hasn't read any of Terrence's poetry or visited the blog, please do. He has very inspirational and thought-provoking literature. It's not like one of those things to where you're like, oh man, he's gonna make me feel sad, talk about all this sad stuff, blah blah blah. It's always uplifting and encouraging, so it's always a good read. So you guys go ahead and purchase, read, subscribe to the blog, everything, because, you know, that's some good stuff, man. And I'm glad that you are taking this month to, you know, embrace the whole culture genre of poetry, because, you know, that's the heart of a lot of Black culture, you know, and
right.
And we got to keep that type of art living in this world where there's, you know, everything is kind of like, you know, going away. We got to preserve that. So
right,
great. I'm glad that you are keeping that going, and I'm still waiting for you to do that podcast, man.
I'm gonna try to get started. I like how you segued into that. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna try to get it started this month. Actually, we'll see, man. I'm trying not to let it go past this month.
All right. Well, that's good. That's good. So here we are. I don't even know how to start this.
Yeah.
So when you heard the bonus content with Minister Jeff Jones, what was your first thought?
Okay. First of all, I was like, you, like, were you the only person around when you said this? Or just you? You said this in a class full of people. I was just like, what?
And I don't know if we're doing spoilers or that, but I was just like,
oh man.
So anybody that doesn't know what we're talking about, please go back and listen to that. It's about 12, 15 minutes long. And it's basically talking about why God created Eve. No spoilers, but I tell you, I wasn't expecting.
Me either.
As a matter of fact, let me say, I didn't know what to expect, but I've known Jeffrey for a long time. He's older than I am, but he's always been around since I was little. And okay. he says some funny stuff sometimes, but you know, I wasn't expecting it to go down the route that he went down, but at the same time, it's kind of like a thought that I've had in the past too. You know, April had the same type of thing. So
you never had that thought.
You never had that thought?
I'm just like, when he said it, I was like, wow, I could see that being a thought process behind everything. And I another thing I loved about his interpretation is that he kept saying that that's just my own interpretation. He didn't say, you know, I really appreciated that part too. But it was so wild that I was just like his instructor said, like, what church do you go to? Because that's what I would have asked too. Like, where are you getting this from?
Man, I don't know. So it's like he looks at things in a different way, which I really appreciate. And he does have a balanced view of it. So he kind of like puts himself, he takes himself out of himself and at least is acknowledging the fact that it's his opinion, his interpretation, not something that something that was pushed upon him, you know, which I really respect people that have an unconventional thought process around things.
Yeah.
And me too. The thing that it didn't, like, even though I wasn't expecting it, it didn't super surprise me, is because I think of things kind of like that too. So
yeah, me too. But that one, it threw me off, because sometimes I think about things as kind of, I go kind of out there, and I guess that's part of our creative minds, because, you know, we both are creatives in our minds. You know, we, to have imaginations like we do, we have to go kind of out there sometimes.
It went out there, out of space, man. You got to go past Mars and come back, you know?
Yeah.
Like, where you been? Boy, let me tell you. So let me ask you, because we both grew up in the church, we probably went to Sunday school, because that's the thing in the Black church. You go to Sunday school before it's regular service, blah, blah, blah. They teach you about all that stuff when you're little. I know we were taught certain things because of, you know, church. They have this framework of how they deliver the interpretations of the Bible and all that. But what is your interpretation of why God created Eve?
Mine is the same. Like, even though we learn that it's not good for man to live alone, as I got older and stuff and understood, you know, as far as how we as people connect with each other, and being alone is like torture, because if you think about it, when in prison, they have solitary confinement as a punishment.
Yeah.
And so, you know, learning that part about it, I was like, yeah, so this is true. This is why Eve came along. It's because it's not good for man to live alone. And I was like, wow, okay, yeah.
But was he technically alone because there were animals there, you know? And we watched The Jungle Book, and you know, Mowgli. I mean, that's a fictional
story. I know, but I got you.
But I mean, you know, he didn't have a Baloo that he can like eat honey with and stuff like that, you know.
If you want to go technically, there were animals and things around, but there wasn't another person. He was there by himself. So even though, you know, God came through and there, it was like Adam was still alone.
So the animals were not enough. needed some same species companionship, is what you're saying.
Right.
Makes sense. Because, you know, I think a lot of people went through that during the pandemic, you know, if they were single.
Yeah.
Or if they were estranged from people, they were like in isolation. And even if they had pets, you know, pets only get you but so far with the companionship.
Yeah.
And, you know, they can't speak English back to you, or, you know, they're probably going to agree with everything you say. So it's not the same, you know?
Right.
So do you think it was figurative or literal how the whole creation process from Adam's rib happened to create Eve?
I think it was, wow, that's a good question. I think it was literal. Being a standpoint of creation and creating, I think it was literal.
So you think, okay, so God took the rib. Okay, so did he take both sides of the rib, or did he take like one side and he was like lopsided and he had to lean?
I don't know that part. And in this conversation really has me interested in digging in a little deeper and seeing, I guess, from a theologist's mindset. Because I'm thinking like literally, you know, he took from Adam's rib and created a woman.
I mean, I can look at it both ways, you know.
Just,
I can
see, yeah.
Because the Bible was written, okay, I'll separate things out. The Bible was revised during the age of Shakespeare. So, and we weren't back, we didn't live back then, you know. So
right.
Things could have happened back then, and it was just Adam. So, you know, if some weird stuff happened, people wouldn't be crying like UFO and stuff like that, or trying to lock him away or crazy stuff, because it was just him. So magical things could have happened, right? Could have happened. We weren't there. We can't tell. But I know that when it got to King James and such people, they made it sound really poetic. So I could see it being like literal, and I could see it being figuratively, you know, taken of the rib. Because
right.
A rib is kind of like a necessary part of the human structure to keep you upright and support your organs, right? Because if you don't have ribs, your guts would just fall out, you know?
Yeah. Y'all okay. Come on here, break it down, brother. Break it down.
Bring it down. Yes. So I mean, I can see it both ways, right? But I don't know which one could be true, because again, we weren't alive back then, right?
Right.
But all I know is there was this rumor that, you know, Janet Jackson had a rib or two taken out, you know, and I'm like, well, first of all, I don't know if that's true, but then I always think back to, well, maybe it was literal that God took the rib from Adam and created Eve. My only thing with that is, how bony was she? You know, because it's a bone. So you created from, how much flesh was on this woman when she was first created? Because it take from a bone, not flesh, not an organ, but it was from a bone. So how does she look at first? You know?
See, you're going way, way deep into it, man. See, we passing Mars. We passing Mars.
Yeah, we're going to Jupiter.
So now you taking it to a whole sci-fi situation. Like, so okay, if correct me if I'm wrong. So what I'm seeing is you're getting a visualization like the movie The Mummy. And every time when he kept getting somebody, he kept getting like a little piece of himself until he became a full person. So you're thinking she might look like the starting version of that?
I wonder. I mean, I don't. I'm just. I'm thinking, man. I'm glad you brought that up, because I love that movie for one. And maybe that could be true. Like, that might have been the foundation. And then Adam was like, ew. And then God was like, you still don't like that? All right, cool. And then maybe that was the foundation of her you know, her existence, but there had to be maybe some work done over time. She maybe it was a nature and nurture type thing, to where he had to do something that God told him to do to help her form into what we know as woman, right? And I always kind of got pissed off at the kind of misogyny type thing that, you know, women had to be derived from man. Because it's kind of like the chicken and the egg thing, right? You know, we come from women. So why did they have to come from us?
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah, okay. Okay. Back to the part about, we'll get to that, but back to the part about the piecing together. I mean, you know, God made man out of dust, and I don't think it was like a long, strenuous process, because the way we view time is different from the way that God sees time. Or God, you know, God is infinite. You know, he moves through it like there is no time, pretty much.
Right.
So, in my mind, is when he took the rib, you know, that's when he formed Eve, just like that. I don't think there was and like I said, we don't know, but I in my heart don't feel like there was a long, you know, mutating process before she became a full woman. You know?
So it wasn't like the mummy.
No, definitely wasn't like the mummy.
Well, that's good. I mean, I could go off on a tangent about something, but I won't do it.
I know. We're trying to keep it.
Charlie, you're the host. Contain it. All right. So, I mean, I can see that happening. So Jeffrey brought up the whole thing about, I don't want to do spoilers, but he brought up the whole thing about, you know, Adam having certain connections with, you know, these different species of animals, right?
Right.
And how we look at certain things that happen today, especially when the internet first came out, we're like, ew, y'all people nasty, you know. So, like, did if the possibility of that did happen before Eve came along, do you think that kind of suppressed the urge? Because I mean, I could kind of see it happening, because he didn't know right from wrong, you know, and he was just out there thinking that he was another species of animal that. You know, I'm not human. I don't hold dominion over these animals. I'm just frolicking out with these folks. And, you know, there was no such thing as English. So there were just signals and gestures. So do you think that kind of like immediately like changed how Adam interacted with animals and they kind of separated the relationship between the species of human and animal? Or was there like a period to where, you know, there was all this nasty stuff happening until we had more of a cultural dynamic where we had like, you shouldn't mess with animals type thing?
I think it was already a unwritten ruler thing. I think that though Jeffrey's interpretation does, you know, I can see where that thought would come from, but I think, even though, you know, Adam and Eve didn't know about sin and stuff like that, and, you know, they didn't know they were naked and things like that, I think that the boundaries were already set for certain things.
Right.
So I think, yeah, I think all of that was just pretty much already set.
That makes sense to me. But I'm still struggling. So they didn't know they were naked. Right?
Right.
So they walk around naked because they didn't know they were naked, right? And then they ate from the tree of life, which they weren't supposed to. And then they knew they were naked. And then You know what happens when you realize you're naked? You do naked people stuff. And then they start to have a family, right? So I have a slight indirect but associated question with that. Do you believe that we are all really derived from one instance of an Eve, since she is the initial human source of life, or just tell me, what do you think, how that happened? Because we have different races of people, people that don't look alike, you know, we don't sound alike. Of course, that's, you know, over time because of language, but do you think that she was the single source of how humans came to populate the earth?
And that's a good question. Boy, we going deep. I've always wondered about that because, and I've never taken the time to, I'm going to be honest, like, study and try to find out. This conversation will probably make me try to figure it out now, study. But it's, we know from reading the Bible and stuff that there were other people. So my thought when I found that out is like, so since Adam and Eve were the first and they were in the garden, like, where did everyone else fall into play? And like you said, was she the beginning of everybody? Mm-hmm. Like, that's the part that's always been a question to me as well. Because I mean, yeah, that's a really good question. Like, was she the beginning, you know, as far as the first woman, or was she the beginning as like everyone comes down from her?
Yeah. Because if you look at the History Channel, they always have these things that go back, and, you know, it always goes back to, they try to say it's from one single origin, and based on where they located, you know, on the earth where they believe it took place, she was black, you know, because of, it was somewhere in Africa, what we know now is Africa, right? So I just really want to know if there was actually more than one instance of an Adam and Eve, or that those were the single, like, group, one group of humans that started off, you know, the whole, you know, evolution of humans. I wonder.
Yeah, because, and then another thing about it too, and not to go too deep, I mean, we're already deep, but like, when you look at the people in that part of the world, in Africa and over there, continent of Asia, things like that, everyone over there has darker skin. Mm-hmm. And so even looking at like the map of the world, and I don't know if you remember in school, I think they call it Pangea or something like that.
That's right.
Pangea. Where they said it was all one, pretty much one continent.
Yep.
And if you look at it, it looks like they pretty much did fit like that. But then you look at how in the Bible, with the Tower of Babel, when they were building the tower, mm-hmm. and that was how the different languages came about. And then, like, with my own thought, like, when I was younger, I was thinking about that, like, okay, the Tower of Babel, and then just in general, with, like, people migrating to different areas, languages change. Like, look at South Carolina. Oh. When you're more towards the coast, there's a Geechee Gullah accent.
That's right.
But then you go further up, it's more of a southern accent. Like, if you go, like, Greenville, Spartanburg, even Columbia.
Yeah.
And so, yeah. It's like, I don't know, but this is some really good conversation, man, because now you're going to have me looking up this stuff. But yeah, I think that
this is the stuff that I think about all the time, you know, sober.
I have thought about it, but I haven't thought about it in a while. But yeah, because I mean, if you look at like Africa in general, like even when we talk about Jesus and, you know, speaking of that, I was in third grade and there was a South Carolina history book that we all had to read. And I remember in there specifically where they said that they changed and altered the image of Jesus to keep slaves under control.
I believe that.
And I was like, wow, because, you know, when people say that the Bible is made up and stuff like that, I'm just like, okay, so if I'm trying to control people, why would I make a book that takes place over more so where they're from, with people with darker skin, and then put it in a language that they can't understand and make it illegal for them to read or write? It doesn't make any sense to me. I'm like, that part doesn't even, come on, y'all.
And I think that's a lot of the thing that we are trying to dig through to try to find the truth, because, you know, I mean, we don't speak for other races, but, you know, being Black, we were taught certain things in a certain way. And especially that for our ancestors, they, you know, they were given imagery to, you know, conform to this control.
Right.
So they wouldn't, I guess, so they could feel powerless. And they can look up to, you know, I want to look up to the white man, you know?
Yeah.
Because he, Jesus was portrayed as a white man, but I mean, looking at the time back then and how they described him in the Bible, kind of came off as Black to me.
Or
darker skinned, you know?
Exactly. Because even if, you know, people try to say, well, he wasn't Black, or okay, well, if you don't want to say that, then you just look at that part of the world. I mean, everyone over there has darker skin.
Yeah. So I'm glad you brought that up, because that always makes me wonder how much that came into play when, you know, it led up to his, you know, his crucifixion. You know, was he of a darker complexion, and was that easier for Pontius Pilate and the Romans to kind of like figure like, okay, you know, this darker skinned dude is going out here preaching the good news of, you know, an entity that we can't see. And he's, you know, all these miracles are taking place, and we're trying to, you know, suppress the power of people that, you know, we deem lesser of us. Because, you know, Rome was really, really known for enslaving anybody that they possibly could, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, I wonder how much that came into play of him being the actual darker complexion person. And that kind of accelerated the buy-in from, you know, the whiter people, that he has to go. Like, Black people can't have this much power, you know. I wonder if that came into play.
That's pretty deep, man. Now you got me thinking too.
Yeah, man. Mind you, I'm sober. I don't know what's going on right now. I think you're bringing it out, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Conversation we had before we started recording. That's what it was, man.
Damn. Boy, we have to record something about what we talked about later.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, that has me thinking, because we're on what we designate as Good Friday.
Right.
Which talks about the crucifixion and the sacrifice that Jesus, you know, laid down his life for on the cross for our sins, you know?
Right.
And then Easter is all about celebrating the resurrection after that crucifixion. And if you look at, you know, the stories of the Bible, and, you know, they have a couple of movies out, he was like between like two thieves, right? Jesus was hanging on a cross, and he had like what was deemed as thieves by him, and he forgave them. And back to that whole thing about him being darker skin, I wonder if that kind of played into, like, we're going to lump them all together. And, you know, dark skin guy that does this magic stuff, and these guys that supposedly stole, might as well just knock them all out in one shot, right? You know? Did I make you laugh now?
Oh, gosh.
I'm thinking about this, right?
Because yeah.
It kind of makes sense to me when you think about, if he was lighter and if he came from a a more prestigious background, they might have kind of given him the benefit of the doubt and maybe tried to bring him in as maybe kind of a ministering type person into Rome. But, you know, maybe because he was darker skinned and he had nappy hair that they didn't want him.
That's a very good thought provoking layout you have there. Yeah,
I think you're judging me. Yeah.
No, I'm not, because I'm just like, wow, yeah. So like I said, I don't have the, you know, I don't have the deeper knowledge to say otherwise. But I'm just like,
yeah, we're just talking out loud. We're just thinking, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, who can really prove or disprove any of this stuff? It's just we're thinking, you know.
Yeah. Hypothesis. Yeah, and some very good thoughts you have there. Yeah. Because it, and that's the thing about it, what you're saying, it does make sense. But then it makes me wonder also, because I knew there was, we do know that there was and still is some discrimination depending on where you were from.
Yep.
And your religion. And what, so did it really go deeper as far as skin tone?
Yeah, you know, that's usually the defining factor when it comes down to it, you know.
Yeah, was it more than just race? Yeah, because I know there were certain things that people wore so you could kind of tell them apart from, you know, different groups, but did it actually go any deeper as far as skin tone? That's a very interesting thought.
Yeah, I mean, that type of stuff, just, I don't know, it just makes me think, because why would they feel the need to change the color of his skin to suppress a group of people, when I believe at some point in history, when the news traveled of this prophet, he didn't kind of, from what I know about the story of Jesus, he wasn't going out there saying like, hey, be a part of my religion, blah, 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 follow me and don't believe anything else. He just spread the good news of love and healing. And I think it got like put into a box later so people can use it for malicious reasons, you know?
Yeah, because you think about like slavery and stuff like that, and how you're bringing a group of people over to a country, a land that truthfully you're not even from.
Right.
And so you forbade them to read, to write, things like that, to keep them from also communicating, but you still couldn't stop, you know, people from communicating, because you gotta think about it, these people were communicating in their own land.
Swahili?
Yeah.
Why is Swahili like one of those things that are in any type of foreign language literature book to teach? Why is that?
A good question.
Yeah, it's probably the same thing. It's still
man, yeah. I'm gonna have a lot of homework after this.
No, yeah. You will not be graded on this.
Yeah. But like, I mean, for personal knowledge, because I'm interested in wonder. Well, I mean, I have my assumptions why. Though. Yeah, I have my assumptions why, but yeah. Cause even when like going to the movie The Book of Eli, you seen that, right?
Love right. The movie.
And well, it's no spoilers. Everybody should have seen it by now.
I should hope, but I should hope by now. If we have it, whatever. It's on HBO Max. Yeah,
It's on you. But how?
How you die? You not watch a Denzel movie? First of all,
right. So, the guy in the town, his men looking for a Bible.
Mm-hmm.
Because he knew how powerful the Bible was. He knew how powerful the words are, how it could, it inspire, uplift people. He knew that. But he knew if he had it and he was the only one with it, he could manipulate it.
Hmm.
And I think that's what a lot of people do who are into manipulation. And I think that's what they do. They find something of value,
mm-hmm.
something life-changing, something that can help people, and then they take it and twist it for their own purposes. Hmm. Because if I can distract you by attaching what I'm trying to do to you by something good, whether it be using scriptures or whatever, I can just slide right into it with my own ill intent, and you won't even see it coming unless you have an awareness or a relationship. And that's where it gets tricky, because a lot of people who prey on people with manipulation and stuff like that, they hone into that weakness on a person, or that void that a person is trying to fill.
Yep.
And so once somebody's doing that, it's like you take the Bible, or you can take anything good and twist it. Just like with people who, like guys who prey on women who are vulnerable, and then who've been broken and been in bad relationships, they come in as this good guy.
Hero, yes.
Yeah, this guy who does all the stuff, the right stuff, the stuff that she's not used to, while the whole time they're disguising their real intentions.
Yeah.
And it's like
clothing.
Right. So it's just like with that, and you know, having the Bible going back to, you know, the book of Eli, like he knew, because when they were having a conversation, he was like, he know the words of the book. And he was like, you know, I grew up on that and I know its power. Mm-hmm. And his whole thing was domination. I mean, the man was hoarding the water supply from people just so he can control them. And so when you have like ill intentions, you can make a good thing bad, especially to the unsuspecting and somebody who, you know, sees you as in a place of fear, because that's another way people manipulate.
Yep.
They come in with fear. So here it is. You captured me and my family. You brought us over to this land that's not ours. And now you're forcing us to work for you. You're giving us scraps to eat. You're whipping, you're beating us, you're separating our families. And then you use this as a force of fear. And manipulation and control. It's like manipulators and controllers, they will use whatever they can to do what they want to do.
And it feels like at some point in history, those same type of people with that type of personality discovered that they can have an industry called marketing, you know? And yeah. They can merchandise anything by manipulating people with their already current beliefs to believe in something, because there is some type of association that they have that's dear to them, right?
Right.
So, and it's a good segue, right? So with Easter, it's supposed to be about the crucifixion and the resurrection of Jesus, right?
Right.
But somehow down the line, we got the Cadbury Bunny. We got Easter egg hunts.
Yeah.
And so we were talking about this after you listened to the pod that I had with Jeffrey, and you dropped some knowledge on me about how those two things came together, meaning the rabbit and the eggs, because I brought up like, and I hope you know at this point, people, that, you know, rabbits don't lay eggs. So you kind of had like this disconnect in your mind, like, man, that don't make any sense. What is that? But you dropped knowledge on me. So tell the people about those two connections and what we know in the association of Easter.
Okay. I don't know when the shift happened. But it's a goddess, Estra or something like that. I can't really remember her name, but this was a goddess of fertility. And so in worshiping her, it was like rabbits. They use rabbits because, you know, rabbits, they multiply. Like when they have offspring, they have like a bunch of other rabbits. Mm-hmm. And then the egg was a representation of like new beginnings, new life. And so those two things were used, I guess you would say, to worship her or whatever. And so that's where the correlation between the rabbit and the egg came to place, because those two things were representative of fertility. Now, I don't know how it it came to cross with you know, what we know as Easter today. And, you know, right. That's why a lot of people call it Resurrection Sunday. They don't say Easter.
Ah, okay.
Because they want to separate the two because they understand that it's two different things.
It's kind of like how, like, Santa Claus and Christmas, right?
Right. That's like, I was about to say that, too. Like, how did that? Yeah, so we're just going to – Jesus's birthday and his death and resurrection, we're going to tie into, like, a holiday and market off of that.
You can't have nothing. You can't have nothing. Like, y'all, you really? Y'all got to – all right, my birthday? All right, you know, resurrection? Really? Like, really? So, first of all, y'all going to give presents, you know, for my birthday. Y'all ain't give me nothing. You know, but attention, barely. And then I died for your sins, got resurrected. Y'all go Easter egg hunting and go to church with these fly suits on. Come on, man.
Yeah. And then I like what Jeffrey said in the pod y'all did when he was saying how, you know, the Easter eggs and stuff like that was just more so for the children because a child's mind is different from an adult's mind. And I was like, yeah, I can see that. But it always was kind of odd to me, especially after I learned about that. I was like, why are we still having Easter egg hunts at church? And I know it's cool to include kids and things like that, but at the same time, it's just like, you know, you associate Easter Resurrection Sunday with Easter eggs.
Were you good at Easter egg hunting?
Yeah, I was.
I was terrible at it.
I was, because that's my thing, like puzzles and stuff like that, man. I used to eat that stuff up, man.
Man, let me tell you, I didn't get good. I didn't get good at Easter egg hunting until I was almost at the age where I shouldn't be doing it.
Ah.
Yeah. And I didn't take it seriously. Like, I don't know. Like, I used to help my mom dye the eggs to use for the Easter egg hunt. And I would be like kind of like the last one out there searching for it because I just got stuck doing some other stupid stuff inside the church. But, you know, they do at the church. It's usually, what is it, on that Saturday, the weekend of Easter, they usually have it. And I mean, I kind of didn't care. And plus, it's kind of like the start of spring. So they hid it in places where bees was at. I'm like, man, I'm going behind that bush, man.
Right.
You know, I got stung by bees a few times when I was little. And plus, you remember that movie My Girl was out there and, you know, little Macaulay Culkin went frolicking in the woods.
Yeah.
Well, he shouldn't have. He got stung by bees. He died. I was like, I ain't gonna turn out like that. So, I mean, I was terrible at it. Oh, man. That's not one of my fondest memories at all. And then on Easter Sunday, you see people that you haven't seen all year long. And they could have been in jail, they could have been in the hospital, they could have been laid up sick, but they find a way, and we both grew up in relatively the same area. The boys went to either Superbad or Bluestein and got a real fly, like a pastel color suit.
Yes, bright and pastel. Yeah. Yeah. Oh,
Jesus, have mercy.
Down to the shoes.
Oh man, you better have that flow shine shoe, boy. Oh, to get them gators. Oh.
Yes.
You they got had, that, they that, had the
that
special
pink suit with the pink gators or the yellow suit, yellow gators.
And the little handkerchief. You had to have to match a handkerchief. And oh, man, come on.
And if you had a brim, you was really killing it. You put on a brim. Oh, man.
Don't let it match with the suit, man. Don't let it. But people used to bring out, you know, the Sunday best. Like, people used to have cars that they never drove unless it was on Sunday. And since they really went to church on Sunday, they would they would bust out. I'm like, hey man, I didn't know you was balling like that. The boy bring out the Lexus, the Mercedes and all that. I'm like, you sure is living good. I'm glad you're doing
well.
Yeah,
and that's so crazy. Yeah, that is so crazy because it's just like people would actually spend a lot of money into getting dressed to come to church on Easter to be seen, or Resurrection Sunday to be seen, and not even taking into consideration of what it the day represents. It's like, yeah, I want everybody to see me. And it's just like, some people got into debt just to buy some fly clothes and just to be seen.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And I remember
later at Bluestein.
Yeah. I remember seeing, like,
along, you know, the years, churches like actually saying, okay, on Easter Sunday, we're going to wear jeans and t-shirts. Like, we're not even doing the dress up thing.
Good.
You know, it's just like, we understand some families are, you know, having a hard time and we can't help them as much as we would like to, but we're not going to let y'all sit here and go broke trying to get your kids certain clothes. Because, I mean, let's be honest. Why
do they feel the need to do that? Like,
that's what I'm trying to figure out.
Where'd that come from? Yeah, like
a lot of things that we were doing and are doing, it's like, those are other thoughts I have too. Like, where did this all start from? Like, why do we do this?
I'm sure it wasn't all the way back. Maybe it was back to slavery.
Yeah. Though, you know, like who said, okay, this is when I wear my, you know, I got to get a new fresh. And maybe it has to do with spring.
I don't know.
But why? Why is this this need to get extra fresh and buy all this stuff and these clothes, especially for little kids who 3-4 Sundays from now, they won't even be able to fit the clothes anymore because they've grown so fast. It's just like, come on, man.
You know what makes me think? Because I left the church a long time ago, but I started to look at how things were associated. And here's one example, Christmas, right? Around that time, if you're not Christian, you usually celebrate that time as the winter solstice, right?
Right.
We don't really know if that's around the actual time that Jesus was born. They just, you know, did that, right? So when it comes to Easter, first of all, how do we know that it was around the springtime? Second, they said it was the third day, but time was calculated a lot different back then versus how it is now. So did he actually rise after 3 days? And we count it as a calendar day, you know, from the day that he was crucified. Do we count it incorrectly? Or was that all a part of the larger, you know, marketing ploy to get us to associate a specific time of, and Easter's not always on the same date though, but.
No, it's not. That's crazy too. It's sometimes not even the same month.
That's what I'm saying. And based on how, and I don't know how related this is to like Groundhog Day, because you know sometimes they give us more winter days versus earlier spring. Does that have anything to do? Like, are we not even supposed to recognize Jesus' resurrection around this time of year? Was it actually in fall? Like when we go to the fair, was it around then? I don't know. Was it cold? I mean, that part of the world doesn't really get cold that much, but really, like, I'm just saying.
Yeah.
Was that a part of the larger marketing, you know, package? To like, all right, you dudes, you know, I know you can't really go back in time and figure out when all this happened. So we'll just tell you. And you guys just wear your Easter suits and all that on that designated Sunday on the calendar. And then, you know, you guys do Easter egg hunts and all that stuff. It's stupid to me. It's like really dumb because it feels like we're constantly being misled just so they can pour more money out of our pockets. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think it was still like 3 days, even the 3 days, like our calendar and stuff like that. I think it was manipulated into being something to market. And like you said, it's like, as a matter of fact, my wife and I were having this conversation the other day. I was just like, matter of fact, we have this conversation every year around Easter because we.
Sound like you fell down the steps. Still there, man?
Oh, I lost my, okay. I lost my headphone. Okay. Can you hear me?
You did like I did earlier. Yeah.
Okay.
You're here.
Okay. So, okay, we'll just start that over. So my wife and I were having this conversation the other day. We have this conversation pretty much every year around Easter. We're like, when is Easter this year? Because, you know, it's one of those holidays that just does whatever it wants to do. Sometimes it's in March. Sometimes it's in April. And then we were like, man, I wonder how that started. Neither one of us looked it up. But I'm just like, how is it that Easter can jump around like that? And does it is it does it have anything to do with celebrating, you know, the resurrection, or is it something having just to do with the calendar? But why is it like it doesn't fall on like pretty much the same month?
It's interesting to me. I don't
know. And did it have anything to do with this daylight saving time thing, or I don't know.
Or when spring is recognized to start. Yeah, you know, it's it's crazy.
Because when you look at even like with Jesus' birth, like he wasn't born during Christmas time, but that's when we celebrated. I mean, when the three wise men came, he was like a toddler. That's even in the Bible. So it's right? Like that major scene is wrong.
Exactly.
But it's just like, we set aside a time, and some Christians don't get really into Christmas because of Santa Claus and stuff like that. Like Christmas happens to be my favorite holiday. Just because it's
more about family, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And so I look at it like this, like as far as like with Jesus's birth and things like that, like, I mean, look at like our grandparents and stuff like that. I don't know about you, but like our grandparents stuff had like different birthdays.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, we celebrate their birthday one day, then you get older and you find out like, yeah, well, they actually were born on this date. You just like what?
and they had a slightly different name.
Yeah, and see stuff and, like that.
And yeah, yeah.
So it's not far-fetched that, you know, even with that small of a generational change or whatever word you want to use, like that change has happened along the way. So just imagine like hundreds and thousands of years, the changes that happen along the way. And then it's like I found out that the reason why our grandparents and stuff like that had like different birthdays is because the midwife who cared for them or whatever, she would turn in all of the birth certificates at the same time. So say it was like you were born last week. Somebody was born this week and then somebody born next week and I turned all this stuff in. It's like all y'all gonna have the same birth date.
That makes a lot of sense. Yeah. Yeah. And that kind of like screws up the whole knowing what's real or what's not thing even more, because you have the legally documented birthday and the actual date of their birth. And yeah, like somebody just didn't feel like going to City Hall certain times. And they're like, well, you know, I got to go in town. So all y'all about to be born the same day.
Yeah, it's so wild, especially like in South Carolina. Like, and you wonder why, I don't know about other states, but how these people have like these multiple families. And it's like... when I was looking up to get like our marriage license, I found out that in South Carolina to get a marriage license, like you don't even have to prove that you were divorced if you were previously married and stuff.
Really?
And I was just like, this is why you hear stories of people saying they're going to the store and never come back, and then they have a whole new wife and kids. And this is like, because I used to wonder, like, so how are you having another spouse and you didn't divorce this first person? Because they don't make you prove, right, see? They don't make you prove that you're no longer married to this other person.
So how did, so the whole, okay, so it was a cultural norm not to be in a, like, polygamy, right?
Right.
But apparently you can have side families and that's totally legal as long as they ain't all in the same house.
Pretty much, without like a better explanation, I was just like, this makes sense, because we've all heard a story of people leaving and they have like a whole new family, and this is like, but did he ever divorce that other lady? No. So technically, that's his still his wife.
That's crazy.
Yeah. And it's like, back then, stuff was so easy. Like, you hear stories of people just changing their names and then that's it. And then you got you got a whole lineage of family that's actually a name that's not even on your birth certificate.
Makes you wonder how accurate ancestry.com is, you know.
Right.
Don't believe that thing, man.
Yeah.
Not at all.
So but in hindsight, it's just like with information being transferred and stuff like that, and it's like you, like when we're talking about spiritual, religious things, you just have to have a relationship. You have to have an understanding, and these things have to speak to your heart and your soul. It can't just be you believing in something because somebody told you.
That's right.
It's like you have to find out deep into yourself, why do I believe? What experience or experiences did I have, you know, to lead me to the point where I started believing? And what type of relationship am I cultivating along the way to have a deeper understanding, deeper relationship, to where I can't be swayed one way or the other? Because I know in my heart of hearts that I know this is true, this is real. And that's another thing that makes stuff difficult for people, is because a lot of times things are shoved down people's throats. Shoved down people's throat to the point where what's regurgitated back is the wrong version of everything, because everything has just been shoved down. It's like, you've got to do this, you got to believe this, you got to believe that. But it's nobody's taking the time to say, search for yourself, search in your own heart.
Yeah.
You know, build a relationship for yourself. Nobody does that. Well, I mean, I wouldn't say nobody, but like, that's just, you know, not what we were taught. Yeah. That's not the normal going. It's just like, this is what you, this is this, is this, 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 and this. Here you go. Take it.
I think they're, and we know it now as the woke generation. They're the polar opposite of that, you know? For generations, people just took things at face value and just ran with it. But now you got the woke people, which I thoroughly dislike.
It's the total opposite.
They think they know everything. They have to change things that are kind of negative, right?
Right.
You know what I saw today, and I told my wife about this before she left work. I don't know if this was happening last year, but I think something happened during the pandemic where some woke people crept through and made some stuff happen. I sent you a message about this. I saw on the calendar that Good Friday is not on the Google calendar unless you download a specific version of a Christian calendar to Google, but they highlight Easter Monday. I've never heard of Easter Monday until today.
Yeah, me either.
And when I looked it up, I'm like, what is Easter Monday? So apparently these woke people want to take any negative connotation of death and sacrifice away from, you know, the broader celebration of Easter, kind of making it more marketable, right? And it kind of takes the reason, passages say the reason for the season, you know, take it out, and they want positivity about, you know, the day that he was resurrected, and more of kind of like having a parade or, you know, a celebration to celebrate that, oh, Jesus rose from the dead. Let's celebrate the good that happened and not reflect universally on the death part, which I think it disenfranchises the entire
exactly
thing.
Yeah.
And I don't know if I like that at all. Because how you have to have the death to appreciate the sacrifice.
Thank you.
To appreciate, you know, the resurrection, and then you celebrate. You. Because how we especially as Black culture, and every culture does this, when you die, we reflect on that, and we celebrate the life in a place of a funeral. You know, we use that in the form of a funeral, right?
Right.
A going home ceremony, you know, if people don't like to use the word funeral. But now I think they're trying to take that kind of thing away. And how do you feel about that in the relation of the overall thought of, you know, how the real reason of Jesus plays into Easter, Resurrection Day, and all that?
That is crazy.
Yeah.
And like you said, it's that's this. I mean, let's just be honest. People nowadays are becoming so sensitive about things that they're not even sensitive about the right stuff. Like, that whole idea doesn't make sense. And you put it out perfectly. Like, how do you celebrate the resurrection without the death part? Like, all of that ties in together. There's no need to try to sugarcoat stuff. Like, also what they're trying to do now and have been doing, one of my friends told me, is trying to say that slaves were actually indentured servants.
Well,
because they're trying to mask that, the ugly part of how the country was actually built. So they want to just kind of, you can't try to hide stuff and try to sugarcoat stuff. And this Easter Monday thing, that doesn't even make sense, because the gruesomeness part and the death part, that's part of the whole story, the beating and the suffering and the torture that he endured.
I don't want to touch on that indentured servant thing, because that type of thing right there, I mean, there's nuance to it. So I did a lot of extensive research about that, because, you know, slavery kind of is part of our South Carolina heritage.
Yeah, yeah.
And all right, so the whole thing about indentured servants, right? There was slavery first, and there was this perceived pathway to freedom for some freed slaves, but you couldn't, the way it was, is kind of like a work release program for getting right out of jail, you know?
Right, right.
You were kind of forced into that, and it was more of a glamorous name on the, you know, a certain stage of slavery, because you just couldn't go out, get your 40 acres and a mule and survive. You right. had to generate money. You got off the plantation, fine, but how are you going to eat, feed your family? So they built into it that work release program, right? This is not, you know,
right.
And they were like, okay, so you can stay here, be an indentured servant, you know, you basically still a slave, but we give you just a little bit to give you hope to think you're going to be out on your own. And some made it fine, depending on who their master was, but a lot of them still got stuck, and hand down from generation that housekeepers, maids, cooks, moms, so you know, taking care of other people's kids, you know, stuff like that.
Right.
That type of thing is still slavery, but it was perceived as a pathway to independent freedom. It's a lie. To your point, it's a lie. You know,
right.
it's make it sound better, to make the oppressors not sound so oppressive.
Right, you know? Right. And they're trying to make it sound like that's how it started too. Like it started up, yeah. Like there was no actual kidnapping and chains and this sort of thing. It was always indentured servitude.
You don't have to have positive connotations on everything.
Thank
to
you.
Make people feel better. We have
exactly.
to have the tough conversations.
We have to. We have to. You can't sit there and try to pretty up the past to try to be like, well, it really wasn't, or that's a little too gruesome, so let's not talk about that. You have to talk about this kind of stuff. Like that's all of that is a part of healing as well. Even like in our personal lives, we have stuff that, you know, happened to us in the past, whatever. And you just like, oh, I don't want to talk about it. I'm gonna talk about it. But it's like, if you don't talk about it and get it out, that stuff will come back and visit you, man. You used to be sitting there watching TV one day and then boom.
Hmm.
Or you just be walking down the hallway, and boom. You're just like, wow. I hadn't thought about this in like 20 years, and where did this thought come from? It's something you never dealt with. It's just like, and I wish people would actually think about that when they do stuff. Like, put the stuff in your own personal thoughts. Like, it's stuff that we haven't talked about or dealt with that might creep up, or it could be a memory that we just kind of blacked out or choose to forget, but then it pops back up because it wasn't dealt with to begin with, and you try to mask it and hide it.
Yeah, man.
It's like you you can't try to just wash away the past and be like, this didn't happen, or try to sugarcoat. Like, you have to face it and have the tough conversations. You have to be like, hey, this is what really happened. How do we address this? How do we move forward? How do we build? And then trying to wash away or trying to keep the death part away from, like, and now we say Easter Monday.
Easter Monday.
But yeah.
First of all, who gets, all right. So we know some jobs get off that, you know, I don't know if your job gives off or early out for Good Friday. But I don't know anybody that celebrates, you know, Easter Monday. And what does that look like? Is there parades? And they probably just have the Easter Bunny in the parade, like a Macy's thing, you know? It's not even probably about Jesus. I looked up the definition, and in some countries, they interpret that same day that they now recognize Easter Sunday as, I guess, Wet Day? I got to look up where that was, but apparently it was a thing for some people to come out their house and throw water on each other.
What?
See that dumb shit? You see that?
Yeah.
You see what I'm talking about? Yeah. So how did this day become designated that we are celebrating just the resurrection, like the good stuff, you know, the flowers blooming, and not the I don't know, man.
Everyone wants to censor everything and just and just try to make everything so beautiful, and you know, we're just gonna hide that part. We're just gonna talk about this part, but like you said earlier, is you can't appreciate and tell the full story without the death part.
I wonder if it's going to eventually be a part of cancel culture to where you can't really say, like, I don't know, Happy Good Friday anymore to certain people, Happy Easter to certain people, or how some people say Happy Resurrection Day without offending, you know, someone else. Like, is it the fact that we are just trying to appease everyone, and we can't appreciate differences of religion and culture? So things that were recognized are still recognized. Like, how is that inclusive? I don't know.
Right, and that's my point too. It's like y'all are trying to be so sensitive and trying to censor certain things, but to include everyone, but you're actually dividing. It's like you're not seeing that you're actually dividing and separating people and making one religion feel a certain kind of way and another religion feel a certain kind of way. And it's so funny to me, like, how it seems like to be a Christian, you have to be more sensitive to everyone else's religion. But at the same time, everyone else's religion doesn't have these same caps, if that makes sense. It's like,
it does, yeah.
It's like, okay, so we can't do this, we can't do that, because we don't want to offend these people. Okay, but these other people aren't offended. You're offended.
Right. Yeah. It's because, you know, the people that should not be offended that put out there, well, we don't want to offend. Like, man, you the one that's locked in your room,
right,
surfing the internet all day, going down these rabbit holes and thinking people are offended about stuff. Ain't nobody care.
Right, because if you go to another country where the main religion is something else, you think they're going to care and be like, we can't do this because we don't want to offend other religions? No.
They ain't thinking about you.
You know where you are. You know what I'm saying? You know where you are. You know what the main religion is over here, okay?
Yeah.
You know where you are. It's not even trying to, you know, and that's what they try to make. Well, you're just trying to force. No, you're not trying to force what they, you know, stuff on people, but it's like, y'all are trying to be so sensitive and trying to be so inclusive that y'all are dividing. It's like, who's coming up with this stuff when y'all actually thinking? Because even when you get in a conversation with these people who think like this, it's like they're not even going to try to see your point of view. It's just like, no, nah, this is just how it is.
That's Yeah. So there's no bending. They're a hard surface. There's no bending, but people got to remember things that are not flexible break easy, you know?
Exactly. And when you do like research to prove your point, like some of these folks have done, it's like, but the proper research is you have to research the other side too.
Yep.
You can't just sit there and research all the stuff you want to be true.
Yeah. You'll find what you're looking for.
Right. You proper research is researching all variables, all different sides. Come on, man.
I'm telling you, man. That's kind of like the conversation we were talking about in the pre-show. It was like, man,
right.
You know, people just don't want to take themselves out of themselves and be empathetic about other views.
Right.
Hit the mic. And I mean, that's important that I just dislike that the stage of I don't even want to call it evolution. It seems like we're regressing a little bit.
Yeah.
I don't know. It just feels like it's hurting more than helping.
It does. It does.
And more capacities than just this. You know, it's across the board, everything you look at, from politics to something as trivial as passive entertainment. No one can bend on their opinion or just let it be an opinion.
Right.
You can't live in your own thoughts without being forced to justify, substantiate how you got there. I don't care. Just think how you think, you know? Just believe in what you believe. How do I know you're wrong for believing this one thing, you know? How am I supposed to prove or disprove this?
Right, because a lot of times, a lot of us have different perspectives and different point of views and different interpretations of the same thing. That's why it's important for us to have like real conversations and real communication to understand like, okay, you saw it this way, I saw it that way. It doesn't mean that either one of us is wrong, as our interpretation is different.
Exactly.
Now, when it's coming from like something like as far as like movies, like it's crazy to me how, and I think that Marvel has set like such a bar with other movies that people can't enjoy these other movies because they have this comparison.
Yeah.
The stuff like the Winter Soldier and Civil War, Black Panther, like the really, you know, last two Avenger movies, they try to compare stuff to that.
Yeah.
And they say like, oh, this is whack because, and I'm just like, well, why was it whack? And the explanation, you think about it, it's like, okay. Yeah. Like I know somebody who compared the movie Miami Vice to Bad Boys 2. I was like, those are two different type of movies, man. Exactly.
Because it took place in Miami?
Right. And
I
can't forget who the producer was, but he said he didn't want to do it just like the TV show Miami Vice. He wanted to make it more gritty. And it was really gritty.
Oh, that was Michael Bay.
Yeah.
Because Michael Bay did Bad Boys as well. I mean, I can get that, but
it's a different type of movie.
It's even a different type of movie. I don't know if I liked his version of it because it was too gritty in my opinion. And you remember Miami Vice from the 80s.
Oh, love
it. It was all bright colors and all this stuff.
Yeah. You know? And I think that's why I appreciate it because it was different. At first I was like, wait, this ain't man. But then as I watched it, I was like, okay. And even looking at it a second time, I was like, this was done very well because this is the true face of being undercover.
Yeah, yeah.
Like it's not always pretty and flashy, and you just get like this $100 million budget to buy a bunch of cars and stuff, and then you flashy, then you catch a criminal, and no, it's
and
not.
And your clothes stay clean, you know.
Exactly. So that's why I appreciate about it. I'm like, this is how undercover goes. Sometimes, a lot of times, it goes left.
Yeah. Yeah, goes left and down.
Yeah, people die. People die horrible deaths. I mean,
especially in the drug game, you know.
Exactly, man.
It's Miami. It's cocaine all over the place. Somebody's exactly. gonna die.
So I appreciated that, but it's like some people like
they don't like
that. Right. I love all types of genres of movies. Like I'll watch anything pretty much. And so like I go into watching movies with like low expectations or a certain type of lens. And like I know how to separate the two, and I know how to see value in certain movies that other people, you know, don't. They try to compare things. I'm like, but seeing this from just watch the movie. You can't compare stuff to Marvel. That's hard. They've been at this thing for decades, man. I mean, come on.
I think it's a skill, maybe a gift, I don't know, that certain people have to be able to look at levels of nuance and and be able to see differences in things. You may not like it, but that's fine. That's your opinion. But being able to still appreciate
right
it, to the point to where, you know, you're not trashing the thing, right?
Just right.
Because you didn't like it. You telling people not to watch. Don't watch that. Don't watch that.
Yes.
Like, how do you know I ain't gonna like that, man?
Right.
Just like Godzilla versus Kong, man. I don't know. Hey, if you saw my rant yesterday. I don't know if you saw
I did. I meant to comment on it.
Oh my god. I scroll through my feed, and I usually don't do that because it's, you know, I like to think that people on my friends list are very intelligent and well thought provoking people, because a lot of them are people that I work with.
Right.
So my mistake for assuming that, but I scroll through and I'm seeing, okay, this is a waste of time. This is a waste of time. And I look at their page and it's like, they're trashing everything.
Yeah. I'm like,
what are you doing?
Yeah.
What are you doing? You gotta like something. Is it your intent just to, does it make you feel special or important? Does it make you think that you're Cisco and Ebert? And they didn't even trash everything.
And right.
Just to critique stuff. I'm like, can you do better? Like
thank you.
I don't know if did you ever watch iRobot?
Oh yeah, several times. Matter of fact, I own the movie.
Ah, me too. And yeah. There was the part where Will Smith was talking to the robot and trying to spread the fact, you know, like can you write this beautiful music? Can you draw this beautiful painting?
Yeah.
And then the robot was like, can you? Oh, all right. It's like, shut the hell up, man.
Right. Don't discredit me for something that you can't even do.
Exactly. please show me. It's like, those that can't do, teach. Nah, those that can't do, shut the hell up. It goes in there. Spectate. That's what they do. They spectate. Now sit your little ass down and watch this movie and like it. And if you don't, keep that stuff to yourself.
Yeah, it's some people like you said, they just seem like they just don't like anything. And I'm just like, wow. It's like certain people, they say they don't like a movie. I'm like, I kind of figured that. From your reviews on other movies, I'm like, yeah, I'm not surprised.
Even if I don't like a movie, I still try to find something positive in it. I mean, there's only a few movies that I cannot find anything good to say about. But, you know, people take their time, money, invest a lot of this into it to make what they believe is an expression of art.
Right.
And who am I to say that the time and money that you invested into this and the time that I spent to watch it all went in vain?
Right. How,
who am I to say that? And we are both content creators. I think we have an appreciation for at least the attempt. The execution might be bad, but I mean, I have poor execution sometimes. Who am I to talk about?
We all do.
Right.
We all do. Yeah.
Saying. And it goes back to everything that we talked about. It's like, okay, you have to be empathetic, thought-provoking, and have some compassion to look at these things and to understand the nuance of the details.
Right.
But something off subject, but on subject. On subject, off subject. How are you celebrating Easter weekend or Resurrection weekend? What do you call it?
To be honest, it's whatever comes out of my mouth at the time.
I mean, that's okay, right? Either one's fine, right?
Are you
celebrating in church, virtual, in person? Are you doing that the traditional way?
Virtual, still, like, since the pandemic, everything is virtual.
Yeah.
Everything is virtual, which it's, to me, and I know a lot of people would agree, like, that part of having to be virtual, it's helped a lot of people, including myself. Is like, it makes your relationship better because you're forced to cultivate and develop your relationship with God on your own and not try to be reliant on someone preaching to you or looking for a message to uplift you. Not saying anything is wrong with those things or whatever, but some people have become so, like, herd driven.
Right.
To where they lost how to pray about things on their own, how to make things happen, how to get encouraged, even if you're encouraged. Like, people are encouraged and motivated different ways. People worship in different ways.
Yep.
And a lot of times that it gets lost in going to a church because you're looking at somebody and how they praise God and what they do. And then sometimes it's hard for people to say, you know, their praise and worship is different from mine. I don't have to emulate that. It doesn't make me less of a Christian. It doesn't make me less of a believer because I don't do it that way. But a lot of people buy into that. And so they start mimicking and start developing this particular way of worship and things like that. And then deep down inside, they're not feeling the same things they felt before. I mean, presence is still there, but it's just like they become into this almost like robotic thing.
Yes.
And so I think staying home, not being able to go in certain churches, it helped, like, with breaking the cycle of, like, tradition, because a lot of traditional things were wrong. A lot of traditional things that were taught were taught like man-made stuff. It doesn't have anything to do with the Bible. It's just like somebody thought, this is what we need to do, and then that's what you've been doing all your life since you was little. And I mean, unless you're like us, you know, they don't question, well, why are we doing this or why are we doing that? It's just like, I've always been questioning stuff in my mind, like, this doesn't make sense to me. I don't care if you're saying it or not. I know how to read, and I'm reading this, and this is contradicting what you're telling me. So I think
some people just go with it, man, you know.
Yeah, so I think that's helped a lot of people. The people who actually, you know, have been staying home and being virtual, some people still, their church doors are open. That's crazy, but hey, to each his own. I mean, if you have a small congregation, that's cool, but if you have a large congregation, I think you're kind of teetering on the whole, I don't think it's safe. I mean, things are getting a little safer now, but that's quote unquote a little safer. But that's it. I would say, yeah, we'd be virtual.
You almost started up that pre-show conversation.
Exactly. I had to catch myself.
I was gonna let you go. You know, I'm enabling. You know,
I don't talk
people out of doing anything.
Right. We're going to have dinner, you know, the traditional stuff that we always, dinner. But we have dinner every Easter. I mean, we don't have to have like a holiday for a good Sunday dinner. I just love a good Sunday dinner, man.
Going to have some ham. I saw this thing about honey baked ham. Oh, it's so good, but I'm not paying that much money for that thing.
And see, I stopped eating pork, man. I used to bake a mean ham, man. I used to have this like this glaze that I would do, you know, like that condensed orange juice that's in the freezer. Yes, sir. And some honey and some other man. Stuff I used to mix together, man, and put on that. Ooh. Mm. Yeah, man. I'm about to try that on some chicken or something. See if man, it tastes the same.
No, it don't. Telling you right now. No, yeah. Sir. Mm-mm. I don't know. You might have to make an exception. I don't know, man. So no. I tried a few things because when I was back in South Carolina and my sister was still living, she didn't eat pork, so we had to accommodate for that. And I tell you, we cooked things to you know accommodate, but I don't know, man.
Some things you just gotta leave alone.
Yeah, seasoning don't taste the same way on different proteins. Like, I don't eat steak a lot, but I'm just saying, you can't beat a good steak. And I love lemon pepper wings. I tried that on some ribs. It ain't the same.
No, it's not. It ain't the same. It's not. I have tried because we've been like kind of doing like no meat meals because my sister, she's a part-time vegan. And so we did like this, I think it was jackfruit, like pulled pork sliders.
Yeah.
It actually, the texture and everything was like pulled pork or pulled chicken, just depends on your preference. Like a lot of those like vegetarian and vegan meals are like, matter of fact, you're in Georgia, Slutty Vegan. You ever,
it's a tourist trap. I mean, I never been
there. It now, you know, a combo of fries and a burger will cost you like $18.
Oh, no, bro.
But it is really good. Like that's the great best burger substitute, meat substitution burger I've ever had. Like it tastes like beef.
I don't know if you ever ate Indian food.
Yes.
Red dot, not feather. For those that can't distinguish the difference, I'm not talking about Native Americans, but have you ever had Gobi Manchurian?
No.
It's cauliflower. That it looks like it's a buffalo cauliflower. It's really spicy. But I have to send you a YouTube video on it. Oh man, if I ever go vegan, and I have a few Indian friends because I work in technology and you know, developers tend to be of Asian descent, which is a good thing because I don't trust a lot of other people doing that crap. I mean, I'm just saying,
right?
I'm not being racist, but I trust certain things in certain people's hands. And
you think about the value of education is different. And
yes, it is.
That's the way I look at it as far as like being different. Americans and like going to school with kids from other countries and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Like they take education so serious.
They have to have certain level of degrees to get jobs that we just get all willy-nilly.
Exactly. So it's not a racist thing. It's just like if you look at the education, it's an educational thing. Yeah. That's the difference. Yeah.
But the food, oh my God, Subu is so good. They have, there's two of my favorite things that I love, which are Indian dishes. Gobi Manchurian, well, I'll say three. Gobi Manchurian, corn Manchurian, and they take those little baby corn things and they do the same thing as the cauliflower. Oh. And there's one called samosa. And that, it kind of looks like a diamond-shaped type. How do I see this? It's a diamond type shape pastry, fried pastry type thing, but it's not a dessert thing. It has a lot of mashed chickpeas in it, and some other thing, a potato, and some. Oh my God, so good, so good, so good, so good. So if you ever are able to go to an Indian restaurant, get the authentic stuff,
Yeah, you're gonna have to send me those. I'm gonna send me those names. I want to try those.
It's awesome. But we've been talking for a while, and people are like, hey man, when y'all gonna wrap up? Oh. You know, my wife was like, hey man, you know, y'all have some great conversation, but dang, y'all talk a long time. I mean it's real. I talk a lot. We get on a conversation, we don't know how to stop, which is good, but we have some good stuff going on, man.
Yeah, so, and it's always engaging.
Always engaging. So let's wrap up. This weekend is April's birthday weekend, so we might not be doing
happy birthday.
Thank you. Might not be, well, no, thank you for me.
Hey man, that's your wife, man. You can say thank you. It on.
We won. Yes. We won, you know.
Exactly. Fine. Right.
God dang it. It's a reflex. So we might not be doing the traditional Easter thing, probably not. But we are gonna be definitely celebrating in spiritual fashion. But yeah, man, it's always great talking to you.
Yeah, always.
I'm gonna stay on you to get that podcast out. Everybody named Mama is coming out with podcasts. And before we go, let's talk, because I talked to you about this before, and I just want to put this out there. I may cut this and put it into a separate thing. But what we really need to do, and very serious about it, I joke around a lot, you know. We grew up together,
right,
to a certain extent. You know, we went to school together, so we both are jokey people, but we're very serious people,
right?
And so this is serious. With the age that we're in, and we can't be close together, as you know, due to proximity or whatever. I lived in Atlanta for like 9 years now. I just realized that, and you know, we have to look out for one another, especially right, since we're content creators. And we know entrepreneurs out there that are trying to get business going. I'm gonna give a shout out to Daddy's Girls Bakeries.
Holla. Wow, yeah, I've been there, yeah, man.
Yes.
Those chewies are crazy.
I never got a chance to try the chewies, but
please do.
I, you know, grew up with Nate too. We all grew up with Nate. So shout out to Nate. I think I had some of his stuff at a wedding. So he catered the wedding, and man, I forget what it was, but god damn it, I lost my mind. I was supposed to like get like a few things. It was like an hors d'oeuvre type portion, but it was a pastry. I think it was the wedding cake or something surrounding the wedding cake. It was at Maurice Miller's wedding. Man, that was so good. And I know the work that he puts in. So my thing is, we have to, and what I want to get to is, we have to get to a point where we are collectively in this, you know, cross promotion group. We are, you're selling books, you know, you're getting poetry out there, you're doing a lot of good stuff. I'm doing the podcast, you know. You know, our friend Barry, he's got a podcast, and a lot of other people, you know, Brandon Ross, you know, I'm name dropping out there trying to get stuff out there. And we know people that have businesses that, you know, promotion can help. I want to get to a point that we are all doing Black excellence thing. And I don't mean that to, you know, say that we're not going to help people that are not like us.
Right. I got you.
We really have to lean on each other and prop each other up, because people like us are doing great things out there. And we are statistically aware that through history, we have the crab in the barrel mentality that we got to stop.
Yeah.
We got to stop. So any chance we get to big up anybody doing good in the community, doing good, trying to better their life, for themselves or their family, we got to help promote them. So from this point on, any given chance, I don't care who you are, I'm not going to charge. I hope nobody else charges, but with my medium that I have, I would like for us to cross promote each other, to keep that level of Black excellence going, because there's a lot of work we got to get done. There's a lot of work, and it's incumbent upon us to show how we, as our generation, are big up in everyone and not doing that crab in the barrel mentality. And I want that. Truly, I want that for us and everyone. So, you know?
Yeah, that's crazy. My sister, she did some video and photos for Daddy's Girl Bakery.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because I don't know if you know this or not, my sister's a photographer and a videographer.
Didn't know that. I thought you were doing that. You know, I saw some of the production. I'm like, hey, I didn't know he does that too.
That's my sister. I'm trying to get into that, you know, as well, but that's my sister. And then like our friend KJ does Black Food Fridays. I don't know if you see it on Facebook, but the presence is huge on Instagram. And where he encourages,
I gotta get back on there.
Yeah, I'll send you the Facebook link, but the Instagram presence is very huge, where he just asks everybody to support a Black business restaurant on Fridays.
Good.
And that started when the pandemic began, because a lot of Black owned places were closing, and truthfully, they weren't getting the same funding that other restaurants were getting during this time. So that's where that all started.
Mm-hmm. Good.
And so, we definitely need to do something like that.
Yeah.
I agree. Matter of fact, I'll let my sister know too, and we can all brainstorm on that. She can bring some ideas to the table too.
Good. I mean, I've been meaning to reach out to, you know, people like Nate and a few others. I won't name drop everybody because they might not appreciate that. But, you know, I want to reach out to them. And, you know, if you're doing a podcast, if you're doing books, if you're doing anything, if you're doing like food service, you got any business out there. My cousin, he does credit repair. I'm going to start promoting that too. Just a reshare or a retweet or something. But you just don't know how that will increase their reach. So anybody out there, and you don't have to be a content creator, anybody listening to this, just pay it forward, man. Because people like us, you know, doing content, we live and die by our stuff being passed on to others to, you know, to read, listen to, or watch, you know? And they, to a certain extent, that have, you know, businesses are the same, the word of mouth. Because a lot of people don't have money to go out and have commercials like big That's businesses true. Do. And even places like on Facebook that try to nickel and dime for you trying to boost promotion, people don't got money like that. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So we have to take it upon ourselves to do the right thing and to help these people be successful. You know? And I just want to say that.
But, yeah, man. Yeah, definitely. I'm down.
I know.
I'm down.
That's why I mentioned it while you on the show.
I'm down.
I know you down, man. I know.
Yeah.
All right. So before we go, just remind people where they can find you. Plug as many publications as you want, areas to find it. Just feel free. Go ahead.
I'm on Instagram, The Brown Sugar Cafe. I'm on Facebook, The Brown Sugar Cafe. I'm on Twitter. It's The Brown Sugar Cafe, but the O is missing in brown, and I think I took the U out of, I don't know. Just this search me by name. It's Terrence P. Elmore. You search me on Twitter, you can find me there. My blog is thebrownsugarcafe.blog. And yeah, man, hit me up, check me out. That's it.
Hey guys, how you liking the show? How you liking the podcast? How you liking the content in general I'm sending you away? I hope you do. And if you do, and you want to keep making the show better and better and better, which I'm really trying to do, and get it out to more people with the best sound quality possible, and get some possibly celebrities on here and people from the tech industry on here as interviews and panel guests. Oh, that'd be great. Please support the show via the Cash App link I'm going to put on the description. Show notes. Yeah. So, you can also get producer credits by doing so. I'm not asking for a specific amount. Anything that you can give to say thanks. And I thank you for being loyal and listening to everything you can on the podcast channel. I hope you come back and share with your friends more. Be blessed and have a great day.